I've mentioned various cases of Rubik's cubes that are impossible to solve, and Japan has a great video that explains why they are impossible to solve. But let's forget about Rubik's cubes, let's look at this. This is a 15 puzzle. Some people call it Klotzky. The rule is simple. You solve it by making tiles in the order of 1 to 15 with the empty space at the bottom right. The empty space allows you to move tiles. After scramble, the goal is to recover them back in the ascending order. Just like Rubik's cubes, if there are invalid operations, like this, or take any two pieces out, swap them, and put them back, that will make this puzzle unsolvable. In this video, I'm going to explain parity with an example, and then prove some cases in 15 puzzle are impossible to solve. Finally, I'm going to mention some fallacies in logic. If you're transported to a checkerboard where you walk diagonally, can you make it to the exit? If you start here, you can move like this. But if you start here, you cannot reach the exit no matter what. So there are two cases, reachable and never reachable. To tell which case it is, we can give each square in the checkerboard a coordinate. A coordinate is made of two numbers, indicating how far it is from the left and from the top. For example, this person is at the square which is the first from the left and the third from the top, so his coordinate is 1, 3. When he walks like this, his coordinate is now 2, 4. And then at 3, 5 like this, third square from the left, fifth square from the top. Now, parity, it simply means whether a number is odd or even. When this person moves, each of the two numbers will plus 1 or minus 1, respectively. So the parity of each individual number alters in every move. But let's add the two numbers up. In every move, that sum will plus 2, minus 2, or stay the same. Therefore, the parity of the summation does not change. That is, if the sum of two numbers in the coordinates is even, then it stays even no matter what. When the sum of the coordinates of the exit is odd, and the sum of the person's coordinates is even, no matter where the person walks to, it will always be even, cannot become an odd number. Therefore, the person can never reach the exit. In other words, under the rule of walking diagonally, the checkerboard is split into two parts, the even nation and the odd nation. A person in the even nation can never step on the odd nation by walking diagonally unless we break the rule, allow the person to sidestep. How about this 15 puzzle? Every combination of tiles belongs to either the even nation or the odd nation. Whatever cases that follow the rule belongs to the even nation. This solved completed case belongs to the even nation. Scramble it normally, this also belongs to the even nation. However, if we take two pieces and swap them, this breaks the rule. Now this case belongs to the odd nation. If you then slide tiles normally, it will stay in the odd nation. It cannot go back to the even nation. To tell whether a combination belongs to the odd or the even, let me jump to the range value of a sequence of numbers. What do I mean by range? Imagine a bunch of customers take their numbers and stay in line. When waiting in line, if everyone queues by numbers, nobody gets mad. However, if someone with a bigger number cuts in somewhere ahead, those who are behind him with smaller numbers will be in rage. You can also say the man that cuts in line make them mad. Rage is calculated in every pair of persons and can be cumulated. If there are two people with the bigger numbers before a man, then he not only gets angry, he gets very angry, so his rage value is 2. With a bunch of numbers in line, we add up the rage of every number. That will be the rage value of this sequence. Let's look at another example. Feel free to pause the video and calculate the range of this sequence. It will be 4 plus 3 plus 2 plus 1. However, if we swap 3 and 4, 4 used to make 3 angry, but now it doesn't, so the rage will decrease by 1. The two numbers are next to each other, so the only they themselves are impacted during the swap. The other numbers are not influenced. So instead of recalculating the rage from every number, as long as we know the original rage of the sequence and add the rage change between the two numbers, it's easy to know the new rage of the sequence after swapping. Back to this 15 puzzle. We can calculate its rage as well, but the first thing we need to do is to treat the empty space as 16. We look at the tiles as a sequence of numbers, in the order of left to right, top to bottom. An empty space is 16, even if it's not a tile. Therefore, when you slide the tile, you actually swap that number with 16. If I scramble in this way, the whole sequence looks like that. A solved puzzle has zero rage, because tiles are arranged from small to big. How does rage of the puzzle change when we move a tile? When 15 slides to its right, we actually swap 15 with 16. Now 16 is before 15, so 15 is angry and the rage plus 1. If 14 slides to its right, which means swapping between 14 and 16, now 14 gets mad, so the rage plus 1. 15 has been made angry by 16, so its rage doesn't change. And for those before 13, their order remains the same, so their rage don't change. Therefore, the total rage is 2. If we move 14 to the left again, the rage of the puzzle goes back decreased by 1. What if we slide the tile downward?
Conclusion first. Every time we move a tile, the rage of the puzzle becomes even when it was odd, and becomes odd when it was even. In other words, the puzzle rage alters every time a tile is moved. Why? Moving a tile, which I said is swapping that number with the 16, can be treated as swapping two numbers in general. And a swap between any two numbers is equivalent to the number at the back keep cutting forward, and that number at the front keep going backward. Any adjacent numbers, no matter which is bigger, when they swap, the rage of the whole sequence either plus 1 or minus 1. In both cases, the parity of rage changes. So every time two adjacent numbers swap, the rage of this puzzle also swaps between odd and even. So, when any two numbers swap, depending on how far they are apart, it could be one adjacent swap, or three adjacent swaps, or five adjacent swaps. The amount of swaps will be an odd number. After odd times of plus 1 or minus 1, the parity will change. Odd becomes even, even becomes odd. So the first theorem, sliding a tile by the rule, or taking out two tiles and a swap, both change the parity of the puzzle. Back to 15 puzzle, the rage is 0 before scramble. Because all the numbers are in ascending order, so it's even. During scrambling, every time we slide a tile, it means swapping that number with 16. So the rage of the puzzle will alter. But you ask, the parity keeps changing. How can we judge if it is solvable? You're right, so we need a second theorem. After scrambling, when the space goes back to the bottom right, the movement count has to be even, since in every step the space moves between green and red. To move the space from the bottom right back to the same green corner, you cannot do it by moving an odd number of times. An even movement count means the rage alters an even amount of times, so the rage parity remains the same, which is even. In other words, when sliding those tiles, although the rage alters between even and odd, but when the space is back to the bottom right, the rage will be back to even as well. Our second theorem is, when sliding by the rule, when the space is back to the bottom right, the range of the puzzle is definitely an even number. Now, let's take out any two numbers and swap them. As I said, swapping any two numbers alters the range of the puzzle. So now, the parity of movement count and the parity of range differ. And then, you still move even times to make the space back to the bottom right. Therefore, the range of the puzzle will be an odd number. It cannot be zero. So the puzzle is impossible to solve. Conclusion: swapping two tiles breaks the rule, breaks the parity of the puzzle, making it unsolvable. For those who are interested, you might want to search parity of permutation. The idea of the range is actually a proof for any two permutations A and B of a sequence. If there exists an even number of exchanges to transform A to B, then there cannot be an odd number of exchanges to do so. Vice versa. Now, a bit of logic. When the puzzle range is odd while the space is at the bottom right, we prove that you cannot solve it. Now, by this reason solely, can we say it is solvable when the range is even? Not exactly. It's like if you eat kanji, you won't get slim. Can we say if you don't eat kanji, you get slim? It's not true in logic. Let's look at another example. There's a hole on the ground. You've got many 2x1 bricks. Can you use the bricks to fill the hole? Right one is okay, but not for the left one. Because the left one is 3x3, its area is an odd number. One brick occupies two squares, so still odd number of squares left. It cannot be zero. Then can we jump to a conclusion saying that if the area is even number, then it can be filled? Not exactly. This hole has 18 squares, an even number, but no matter how hard you try, there will always be two squares left. If we paint it in a checkerboard pattern, you will see 8 blue squares and 10 red squares. No matter how you put a brick, it always occupies a red square and a blue square. So eventually there will be two red unfilled. Then can we say, if there are the same amount of red and blue, then it can be filled? Not exactly. Take a look at this shape. Oh well, is it solvable for any permutation which range is even? Well, that's beyond the scope of this video.
例如你打翻了，实力的爬不快。这个和魔术方块一样，如果有发生不正常的移动，